morning, everybody.
Good morning.
It's a nice snowy day for our sledding event later. And every day is a great day to praise God. This is a song with echoes at the beginning and the second half. You get to sing either the left side or the right side, so whatever works for you. Would you stand with us for this one?
If you are able.
Yeah.
You are holy.
You are holy.
You are mighty.
You are mighty.
You are worthy.
You are worthy.
Worthy of praise.
Worthy of praise.
I will follow.
prayer to pray every once in a while. Probably like every moment of every day, actually.
Good morning, everyone. My name is Pastor Nat Erickson. Welcome. This is my third week here, so I'm starting to feel a little more normal welcoming you. So welcome. Good to see you, both you who are here and people who are streaming in or will be watching later. We'll be celebrating communion later today, as is probably apparent. Welcome. It's so good to be here and to share this time together worshiping. If you remember, there's a little red books in the end of the pews. If you can pass those down throughout the welcome time, that would be great. Now, if you just want to stand up and say hello to someone around you.
Thank you. Okay, the song we're going to do this morning, and I say we're because you're going to sing the chorus with me. And it's Learning to Lean. When I first heard this song, was probably back in the late 70s, Blackwood Brothers sang it. And I couldn't get out of my head after that. Learning to lean on Jesus. Finding more power than I've ever dreamed. I'm learning to lean on Jesus. That's the part you're singing. And it starts off with that. And that song has helped me so much in my life, because when trials come, it taught me to learn. There's a lesson in it for me. Not this is something I'm suffering through, but God has something to teach me in it. Sometimes I'm a slow learner, but he's taught me much through trusting him and leaning it on him. So we'll start out with learning to lean.
I'm learning to lean, learning to lean, learning to lean on Jesus, finding more power than I'd ever dream. I'm learning to lean on Jesus. The joy I can't explain fills my soul since the day I met Jesus my King. His blessed Holy Spirit is leading my way. He's still teaching, and I'm learning to lean. Now, everybody. Learning to lean, learning to lean, learning to lean on Jesus, finding more power than I ever dreamed. I'm learning to lean on Jesus. Sad, brokenhearted, at an altar I knelt. There I found God's peace so serene. And all that he has is a childlike trust and a heart that is learning to lean. Everybody, learning to lean, learning to lean, learning to lean on Jesus, finding more power than I've ever dreamed. I'm learning to lean on Jesus. There's glorious victory each day now for me, since I found God's peace so serene. He helps me with his task, if only I'll ask. Every day now I'm learning to lean. I'm learning to lean, learning to lean, learning to lean on Jesus. Finding more power than I've ever dreamed. I'm learning to lean on Jesus. Finding more power than I've ever dreamed. I'm learning to lean on Jesus.
Thank you, Don, for that, sharing that song with us. This week, we have a special week where we just take a minute to recognize the scouts in our midst. So scouting is a program that's more than just for youth to spend time together, but to learn about the outdoors. It provides fun fellowship and training for youth in the community, both in terms of useful life skills and also in terms of character and an emphasis on knowing
God to some degree, and we salute and want to recognize the scouts. We have several who are involved in various capacities. So if you are involved in the Boy Scouts, or Scouts, sorry, it's just Scouts now, correct? Just Scouts of America. If you are involved or have been involved in some way, if you want to stand and we can just recognize you and your involvement today. Thank you.
All right. We have our first hymn. It is number 402 in your hymnal. And for me, at least, this is pretty new. Might be brand new this week. And for me, it's nice to have the music in front of me. If that's the case for you, pull up your hymnal. Otherwise, it will be on the screen as well. Please stand and sing with me, "May the Mind of Christ My Savior."
May the mind of Christ my Savior live in me from day to day. By his love and power controlling all I do and say. May the word of God dwell richly in my heart from hour to hour, so that all may see I triumph only through his power. May the peace of God, my Father, rule my life in everything, that I may be calm to comfort sick and sorrowing. May the love of Jesus fill me as the waters fill the sea. Him exalting, self abasing, this is victory. May I run the race before me, strong and brave to face the foe, looking only unto Jesus as I onward go. May his beauty rest upon me as I seek the lost to win, and may they forget the channel seeing only him.
Please remain standing for the invocation.
Glory be to God in the highest. Thank you for the grace that we have found in you. We have gathered here today in the promise that when two or three of us are gathered in your name, you are with us. We have gathered to worship and praise you. May you bless our fellowship, and may we feel your presence within our midst. Bring us the abundance of your blessings until our cup overflows. Thank you, Lord, for hearing our prayers always. Amen.
Praise God from whom all blessings flow. Praise him, all creatures here below. Praise him above the heavenly host. Praise Father, Son, and Holy Ghost.
Upon the rock, the wise man built his
want to mention there is a pastor's blog out there now. You may have received an email about it, but if not, go to the church website, find the pastor's blog, and you'll see a nice little video and things on this very topic.
The first scripture reading today is from Exodus chapter 34, verses 6 and 7, and it can be found in the Pew Bible on page 141. And he passed in front of Moses, proclaiming, the Lord, the compassionate and gracious God, slow to anger, abounding in love and faithfulness, maintaining love to thousands and forgiving wickedness, rebellion, and sin. Yet he does not leave the guilty unpunished. He punishes the children and their children for the sin of the fathers to the third and fourth generation. And I don't have my thing. Is it offertory prayer next? Thank you. Okay, offertory prayer. Lord, giver of all things, you have given us the power to acquire what we have. We pray that you would raise our hearts to you that we may know how to give from what you have given us in order to satisfy the needs of the brother and sister among us and the world around us. May our hearts be moved with love of you that pours forth in love and service to each other and the community, the country, and world in which we live. Amen. And the second reading can be found on page 1531. It's Matthew chapter 20, verses 25 through 28. Jesus called them together and said, "You know that the rulers of the Gentiles lord it over them, and their high officials exercise authority over them. Not so with you. Instead, whoever wants to become great among you must be your servant, and whoever wants to be first must be your slave. Just as the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve and to give his life as a ransom for many."
Working with groups of people is a mixed bag kind of experience, right? On the one hand, when the groups are working great, the synergy is awesome, and you can accomplish things that are just incredibly beyond what any one person in that group could do. And on the other side, when the group is dysfunctional, it's a painful experience for all people, and the end result is usually worse than what could have been accomplished by individuals working on it on their own. Group work was a normal part in my school experience, and that was generally on the high end of the academic spectrum, so group work presented two problems very regularly for me. First, it was usually the case that I could do any part of it better than the other people in the group, so figuring out who should do what is kind of like an exercise of what am I going to do now and what will I redo later. And second, you have to deal with, okay, people want to be in my group because they want a good grade. And yet I feel kind of like, I don't want you to get a good grade just for being in my group. I want you to actually do something. So those were problems that I wrestled with a lot in school. Now, the height of my experience with dysfunctional group work came actually in college at Michigan Tech. So in one of my last semesters, I was in a class called grant writing. I did not want to take the class, but I had to. I was in a group of four people. Two other people did not want to take the class. The last person wanted to, but only because he thought the class was covering other things than it was. So all told, we were a group with low intrinsic motivation about the topic. But within this group, three of us were like, all right, let's do a good job and get a good grade. The other person gave no indication of a desire to do a good job or get a good grade. So we were kind of working as a sort of three-man team out of a four-man. The fourth person showed up sometimes, did a little bit of work, not very much. One memorable meeting, he had either had his pupils dilated that afternoon or was under the influence of something when he showed up. Okay, so he was not the ideal fourth person in a group. But at the end, his name was on the paper we turned in, the grant proposal we wrote. He stood up there for our presentation with us, and we get done, and we go back to our table, and the teacher comes over, says, good work, guys. Here's your results. Right? You're getting an A. Now, the three of us are kind of exchanging glances and thought bubbles with each other, cutting out the fourth person, and the kind of thoughts going on in our mind, right? This isn't fair. He does not deserve that. He hardly did anything. We had to redo everything that he did do. He hardly showed up. Why is he getting the same grade we are? Why does he get the same reward for doing hardly any work? Sure, out of mercy, he can pass the class because he did come more often than he didn't, but he does not deserve to get the same reward for the work that we are getting. That's the sort of frustrated thought bubbles passing between the three of us. Jesus says, the kingdom of God is a lot like a group project where three of the guys in the group worked really hard and the fourth one didn't. And when it comes time for grades to be administered, God, the professor, gives everyone the same grade because they were all doing the same project and they were all working together. Now, in truth, I made up the last part of the story. It was an actual group project. I have no idea what the guy grade he actually got. I just made that up to, you know, give a illustration for this particular sermon, but right, I hope that kind of grabs into something in us, right? That's not fair that he should get the reward that the rest of us worked for and he didn't. That's not fair. I want to read the parable now that we're going to be talking about, the parable of the workers in the vineyard, it's often called. I'm calling it the parable of the generous vineyard owner. It's in Matthew chapter 20. It can be found on page 1529 in the Pew Bible. So Matthew chapter 20, verses 1 through 16. I'm going to go ahead and read that as soon as it sounds like most of us are there. For the kingdom of heaven is like a landowner who went out early in the morning to hire workers for his vineyard. He agreed to pay them a denarius for the day and sent them into his vineyard. About 9 in the morning, he went out again and saw others standing in the marketplace doing nothing. He told them, "You also go and work in my vineyard, and I will pay you whatever is right." So they went. He went out again about noon, and about 3 in the afternoon, he did the same thing. And about 5 in the afternoon, he went out and found still others standing around. He asked them why he had been standing here all day long, doing nothing. "Because no one has hired us," they answered. He said to them, "You also go and work in my vineyard." When evening came, the owner of the vineyard said to his foreman, "Call the workers and pay them their wages, beginning with the last ones hired and going to the first." The workers who were hired about 5 in the afternoon came and each received a denarius. So when those came who were hired first, they expected to receive more. But each one of them also received a denarius. When they received it, they began to grumble against the landowner. "These who were hired last worked only 1 hour," they said, "and you have made them equal to us who have borne the burden of the work and the heat of the day." But he answered one of them, "I am not being unfair to you, friend. Didn't you agree
to work for a denarius. Take your pay and go. I want to give the one who was hired last the same as I gave you. Don't I have the right to do what I want with my own money? Or are you envious because I am generous? So the last will be first, and the first will be last. Would you pray with me? God, as we come to you to hear from your word, we pray that you would speak into our hearts, that you would use these words of Jesus to uncover in us ways that, Lord, we are in need to be changed by you in order to love you more and love our neighbor as ourselves. It's in your name that we ask this. Amen. So here I want to give a few historical notes to flesh out this parable a little bit. First, a denarius. Okay, so a denarius was a normal day wage for a laborer. It was a little silver coin that the Romans made. And the exact value of a denarius is hard to calculate for a lot of reasons. Our economy is different than their economy and so on and so forth. But you could probably buy enough food for a couple days for a family on one denarius. So some estimates put a rough poverty line at about 200 denarii a year. So if you're getting paid a denarius a day, you don't have very many opportunities to not work. The point of the story, though, is that it's the normal wage. So the vineyard owner is not giving anything exceptional, but he's also not skimping out the workers. He's giving them what they would expect to be paid for the work that they're doing for the day. So that's the denarius. Second, Jesus uses day laborers in his example, in this parable. So the life of a day laborer was then, and still is now, a tricky business. Day laborers don't have a safety net. There was no government safety net. So if you didn't work, you didn't have money. So a day laborer was not the sort of profession you would encourage your children towards if you had anything else you could prepare them for. It's not a way to build money and acquire wealth. It's a way to survive. Okay, so these are the sort of people Jesus has in his parable. They're people who need to work this day because they need money today. They're the sort of people who would stop off at the local bakery on the way home to buy food with the money they just got. Okay, so that's the sort of people that the day laborer. And this reality of the life of the day laborer sheds light on a couple points in this parable. First, the pay arrangement. They all get paid at the end of the day. Now, this harkens back to Deuteronomy 24, 14, and 15, and I believe we have a slide up there to see that text. Yep. Do not take advantage of a hired worker who is poor and needy, whether that worker is a fellow Israelite or a foreigner residing in one of your towns. Pay them their wages each day before sunset, because they are poor and are counting on it. Otherwise, they may cry to the Lord against you, and you will be guilty. Okay, so we today are used to getting paid for large blocks of work, right? Bi-weekly, maybe sometimes weekly, monthly even. Usually not getting paid every day for the work that we do. And then we have bank accounts and all the other complicated machinations of the financial system in order to move money around and keep money in different places. Well, the day laborer needed the money that day, so they get paid that day. You do your work, you would get paid on your way out. Okay, and a third point in this parable is that there's something odd in this whole arrangement as Jesus fleshes out this parable. And you can go ahead and take that verse slide down. It's an odd thing that the vineyard owner goes out not once, not twice, not three, he ends up going out like four times in the course of the day to hire people to come to his vineyard. Like, why in the world did he not just hire everyone he needed at the beginning? It's an interesting question to think about, and the sort of thing Jesus's hearers would have been thinking about. You knew how many people you needed to work in your vineyard, so why didn't you just get them? And it sets up the whole point of conflict later in the parable. And a sort of last note in just fleshing out this parable, the evil eye. OK, Okay, so we read in the NIV, and the NIV, like every other English translation, translates verse 15, "Don't I have the right to do what I want to do with my own money, or are you envious because I am generous?" So all of our translations are going to say envious. Well, rather than envious, the text literally says, "Is your eye evil because I am good?" So the evil eye. So our culture is not an evil eye culture. We may have heard that sort of expression, but it's not really something we believe in for the most part, the evil eye. Well, in a lot of ancient cultures, as well as a lot of places around the world today, the evil eye is very much a thing. So what does this sort of evil eye idea mean? So envy is at a core of it, but it's bigger than being envious. So there's sort of two basic ideas behind this evil eye mindset. The first one is that there's a limited amount of good in the world. So if there's 100 units of good in the world, the logical second thing is if someone else gets something good, then that good is no longer available for me. So we have 100 units of good in the world, you get one of them, now there's only 99 units of good to go around. So for any good that someone is getting, everyone else is not just not getting that good, but there's no more good left for them. So this is kind of the heart of the evil eye idea, limited good. So what is the evil eye? Well, the evil eye would come and glance upon someone in a way to injure them. So they receive good, and the point of the evil eye is that it was a glance that would bring injury to those upon whom it fell. So it's a little more than just being envious, but envy hits at like the heart of the idea that resenting someone else because we don't have what we believe we're entitled to, and they have what we believe we're entitled to, even though them getting good from someone else doesn't actually affect us in any way, for good or bad. Someone else getting a blessing isn't actually a bad thing for you, right? But this evil eye mentality is them getting good is bad for me. And so looking at them with the desire that they lose that good so that I can gain it. It's kind of this evil eye idea. So there's a little more punch to it than just being envious. It's not that they're not being nice. It's that there's a degree in which they're unhappy that these other people have got money, and they wish that they wouldn't. So it's a proactive desire for harm towards other people, not just say, "I wish that I would get more." So in effect, the vineyard owner tells them, "Why are you upset and wishing harm upon those who I paid in a generous manner? You were not wronged in any way by me being generous to them, so it's wrong for you to want their harm." Okay, so this is kind of the basic dynamic, the crux in the parable. And we might further extrapolate when we think about Jesus' teaching in the broader context of the Gospels, that the core of Jesus' ethics is to love God with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and love your neighbor as yourself. You can't love your neighbor as yourself if you are resenting good things that come to them. So here we turn our eyes, and hopefully they're good ones, not evil ones, back to the parable and with those sort of details to bring to it. Within the Gospel of Matthew, this parable comes at a really specific point. So Matthew 20, verse 1, begins with the word "for," right? And it's connected directly to explaining something that Jesus had just said at the end of chapter 29, in which he just said, "The last shall be first and the first shall be last," which is also how this parable ends. So we're shown there that this parable is meant in some way to explain what it means for the last to be first and the first to be last. And within context before that, we have the story of the rich young ruler who comes to Jesus and says, "Lord, I want to follow you. What do I need to do?" And then he ends up leaving because Jesus tells him to, right, give up all that he has. So now Peter has a light bulb moment at this interaction, and right after that he approaches Jesus and says, Lord, we've done that. We've left all that we have and we're following you. What's in it for us? It's basically his question to Jesus. And Jesus responds saying, a lot. He promises just staggering rewards to them, as well as in effect saying, you, my 12 apostles, will, when I return in my kingdom, you will reign over the kingdom of Israel on 12 thrones with me. I mean, like, wow. Pretty big reward. And then Jesus says, but the first shall be last, and the last shall be first. And here's this parable. And right after that in the Gospels, we have James and John putting their mom up to go and ask Jesus that they would get the best seats. Right? When they're all sitting on their thrones and reigning with Jesus, they want to sit on his right and left. Right? We just see status, status, status. It's their concern. Fighting, fighting, fighting over status. I want to be recognized. And this parable really hits us right in that craving for status and that desire for other people to get what they deserve when that's less than what we deserve. Okay, we want that status. We want to be recognized. We don't want that person in the group who didn't contribute to get the same grade. We don't want the person at work who does less than us to get the same raise. Right? We want to be treated better, and we want other people to get what they deserve. Right? We want to be recognized. We crave that. So that's really kind of exactly the point, though, of this parable. The whole scenario laid out in the parable is not fair. And God never claims that it is. He doesn't say it's fair. He says it's just for him to be generous. And what he's calling us is to learn to rejoice in God's generosity towards others, rather than being upset, rather than feeling like we're being slighted because someone else is getting something good. So we have this tendency to think we deserve more from God based on how good we are and the work we have done for him and what we have accomplished. Sometimes we see other people getting things, success. We see them getting rewards, and in our hearts, we start to move towards self-justification. Right? I deserve this, they don't. Or we start to move to envy. Why in the world are they getting that and not me? And sometimes maybe even to slander, as we actively look to bring other people down, cut them down to size. Well, in the kingdom of God, God says, I reward generously regardless of how long you worked in the vineyard, regardless of what you accomplished. I'm generous. So if life in the kingdom is to be defined as love God above all and love your neighbor as yourself, we are unable to experience life in the kingdom of God so long as we're busy comparing ourselves with one another, calculating what is due to us and what is due to other people, and envying and resenting what other people receive. Right? These very acts of comparing and calculating and judging and weighing, these acts that are so natural to us as we keep tabs of who's doing what and who we're doing better than and who's doing better than us, they run contrary to the way that God loves and the way that God shows his justice. So this parable challenges us to learn to rejoice in God's goodness even when that goodness is displayed in ways that doesn't make us look better than other people, that doesn't give us a better reward than someone else. And the question that we really have to answer for ourselves, it's a simple and it's a provocative and at times painful question. It's the kind of question that we can't answer in one day, but it takes a lifetime to answer. But we do need to answer this. As we pray, God, may your kingdom come, may your will be done, we have to answer, is God's kingdom what we really want? Would you pray with me? Lord, work in our hearts to love your generous goodness towards others and to not move towards hurt, towards anger, towards resentment when we don't feel like we're getting what we deserve for the work that we do. Lord, our hearts need to be changed by you, and we pray that right now. And it's in your name, for your glory, we ask. Amen.
All right, our hymn of response is 427, I Have Decided to Follow Jesus. Please stand if you're able and we'll sing together. Please sit down, if you will.
So today is a wonderful day as we celebrate communion together. And in communion, we both solemnly remember the sacrifice of Jesus and joyfully proclaim Christ's victory over death that we hope in for all of our hope to come. So as we prepare now for communion, if the people helping will come forward. Paul writes, "For I received from the Lord that which I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, in the night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, 'This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me.'" body of Christ given unto you, this do in remembrance of him. In the same way, he took the cup also after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." This is the cup of the new covenant, his blood. Do this in remembrance of him. For as often as we eat the bread and drink the cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Join now in, "Blessed be the ties that bind." I was forgetting something, my pen. Okay, so anyone have any prayer concerns they would like to, thank you, make the congregation aware of? Yes, surely.
Thank you. prayers would be necessary.
Those suffering in China.
My neighbor, Nancy Sherman, she has pneumonia. She went to the hospital Friday. She's infected with a cold tomorrow, but she's struggling with pneumonia.
Situation in Ukraine.
Unspoken.
The family of John Bilmer.
Bilmer, yeah.
Bilmer, yeah.
Bilmer, yeah, he died. He was kind of a neighbor that lived behind us.
Oh, sure.
They grew up in the family.
Laura Bullard, her husband Mark asked for prayers for her because she's got cancer that has spread and they've stopped treatment.
Who was that again?
Laura Bullard.
Keep us safe on the snowmelt today.
Amen. Okay, let's go to the Lord in prayer. All-powerful Father, you are the Lord of life. You are the Lord of this world. And we bring before you the number of concerns regarding health and people hurting and sick and dying, as well as praises for ways that you have intervened and brought healing. And Lord, we do just lift up these concerns and the many people that they have touched on to bring healing to the body. And Lord, that you would also use the hurts of the body as a reminder in this life of the hurts of our souls that we need to turn to you. And God, you are also Lord of this world, and we pray for the many difficult geopolitical conflicts that are stirring and brewing, and Lord, for the way that those affect real people going about their normal lives and bring so much hurt and pain and injustice in this world. And we pray, Lord, that your kingdom, Lord, would come, Lord, for until then, this will be the normal for us. We pray for peace and for your goodness upon your people and that they may shine as a light in the darkness. And God, we pray these things now as we join together in praying in the words that our Savior taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
I just want to mention to those online that if you have prayer concerns or anything, you can always, through the church website, there's a contact form, or you can email the church. There's an email address listed on the church website as well. We would love to receive your prayer concerns as well. We will now sing a hymn of response, I think. I always forget what these hymns are called, but anyway, it is number 325. It's on the board, on the screen, and it's in your hymnal as well. Please stand and sing with me. Jesus.
Jesus, thy blood and righteousness, my beauty are my glorious dress. Midst flaming worlds in these arrayed with joy, shall I lift up my head. Bold shall I stand in thy great day, for who art to my charge shall lay. Fully absolved through these I am from sin and fear, from guilt and shame. Lord, I shall heave thy precious blood, which at the mercy seat of God forever doth for sinners plead for me. E'en for my soul was shed. Lord, I believe we're sinners more than sands upon the ocean shore. Thou hast for all a ransom paid, for all a full atonement made.
Please remain standing for the opportunities for service.
As you see in the bulletin there, a variety of things happening this week, lots of things happening this week, especially today. Immediately following the service, we'll be having a special business meeting to discuss and vote on the belfry and siding project. Please stay for that. Also, following that, there'll be the family sledding event. If you didn't know about it, now you know, and you should certainly come. And next week, there will be the football Sunday tailgate party, immediately following the service here. And then one other announcement this week, it's actually up on the back wall. Meet the Ericksons. You are invited to invite yourself to our house or invite us to your house. There's dates up there that we would love to get together with people, whether you want to have lunch, dinner, or just hang out. We would love to be able to get to meet people and spend time with people. So go ahead and you can go ahead and sign up there if you would like. Any other announcements?
So, my first announcement is just a reminder about Sunday school. It's every Sunday morning. It starts at 9:30, and we have classes from nursery service all the way up through adults. We have one class of adults doing working through a book of the Bible, and I'm not 100% certain which one they're in right now. Matthew. And then the other adult class is going through a book called The Story, which is the Bible stories in a novel format. And then all the other grades, so preschool through high school, are also working through the story. So if your family participates in those classes, you're all on the same topic each Sunday, which has been an interesting time, especially as we slogged through all the kings and all the terrible choices they made in the Old Testament. It was a slog. My class is laughing. But if you were part of that and then fell away from it, we will be starting chapter 19 next week. We studied Daniel today. Next week will be chapter 19. And soon we are to make the turn into the New Testament. So the stories might become slightly more familiar to us. I also wanted to plug Upper Peninsula Bible Camp. The registration forms are on the table by the coat racks. Jeremy Wright is the executive director of UPBC, and this camp is located in Little Lake, outside of Gwynn. Yeah, he'll be here on the 27th, I think, of February. Camp registration opens at 9 p.m. March 1st, so there isn't a lot of time between Jeremy coming to tell you about camp and registration. So if you are curious, you can get a form. Camp registration does fill up quite quickly, so that's why I wanted to give you a heads up. I'm getting there. Give you a heads up on this so you have time to think about it. Also, the CE board will meet this week to finalize our scholarship application form. We want every kid who wants to go to camp to be able to go to camp. So we have a form to fill out that can do, it's not quite half. I can't remember right now what the dollar amount is, but that information will be on the form next week. But if the scholarship is not enough, please see myself or Pastor Nat, and we will make sure that any kid who wants to go to camp can afford to go to camp. So, camp. Yeah, Mike is already ready to go.
All right, great. As we go from here, first to the business meeting. Oh, another one.
I have a question. Are we going to break to go to the restroom and come back to the business meeting, or are we going to just jump in?
Sure, 5 minutes. And say goodbye to people and go pee if you need to.
Come right back anyway.
Yes.
And before we go flooding today, there are subs and chips and punch in the multi-purpose room, so let's eat before we go.
Great. So as we go from this place, may we find this week that God's loving kindness is great towards us, and that the truth of the Lord is everlasting. Praise the Lord. Go in peace.